Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. said, he said, there is nothing to fear, he quoted from somebody, but fear itself. And Will Smith, in the movie, I don't remember the title, but that's one he did with his son, they went to see, I guess. He says, danger is real, but fear is a choice. Interesting words. Danger is real, but fear is a choice. Now, the Bible has a lot to say about fear. The Bible tells us that in the last days, men's heart will fail them because of fear. Because when they see what's happening on the earth, they will have heart failure and heart attacks. Said many will run to and fro because of what is happening on the earth, looking for a place of safety. He said there'll be distress of nations. And if you look at what's happening today, right in our neighbor Venezuela, various parts of the earth, you are seeing people running, moving because of fear. So this is an age that could be characterized by fear. Paul said it will be perilous times in the last days. Scary times. Fear itself could be good. I know we quote a scripture, the Bible says God has not given us the spirit of fear. You ever took time to understand what he meant by that? But of power and of love and of a sound mind. But fear is how God had wired us. We were wired with that emotion. And it is an important emotion. It is like a emotion that warns you of danger. But what becomes a problem with fear is how you deal with it. And if fear keeps you up all night, there are different levels of fear. There are chronic fears. And some people, they are afraid to even go outside. As we were told, have different phobia word that they use for it, the Greek word, different phobias. Some people are afraid of cockroaches. Some people are afraid of dogs for various reasons. There are some fears that are pretty irrational. Why should you fear for cockroach? There's no rationality in that. What a cockroach could do to you. You're so big and a cockroach so small. It's an irrational fear, but somehow you fear it. People fear what they don't understand. I think God made us that way, so that if something is strange to you, you will pull away from it. And that's ready to protect you. And there are low levels of fear. If you are worrying, it means that you wouldn't call it fear, but it is fear. If you are always a person living in anxiety, similar to worry, you are a fearful person. If you are living in doubt, the opposite of doubt, of course, is faith. And the opposite of faith is fear. But it manifests itself differently. So, fear could be a motivation. Fear does the following to you. Either it motivates you, it paralyzes you, it causes you to flee. Well, you say fear is the fight or flight emotion. It's either you run from something or you fight it. Or it's sometimes you are so fearful that you are paralyzed by fear. Fear caused people to abandon a dream. Fear caused people not to engage in anything in life. So David gives us what I call the antidote to fear in this psalm, because he is saying to us that he and how to be fearless in the face of fears. Now you have to understand that David was a man who lived under constant threat. Back in those days, I mean, where you had might rule. You rule, is that not really one particular government and any, territories were gained by war. You conquer, you rule. You enslave. And there's always on the horizon somebody coming to take you out. So you have to imagine that it's not like we today, you know, who are you afraid of coming to invade Trinidad to take over Trinidad? Nobody. Looks like some say, well, some put fear, say Venezuela could take over, you know. And they could, they have more might. But again, because of our alliances, it makes it difficult. But he was living in a state of constant terror and threat. And that enough is to make you live a life of fear. But in the midst of all that was happening in his world, he was fearless. And of course, in modern day, we have a lot of things that are around us. And I don't know what your fear is, because I'm told every person has a fear, a phobia. Job said, the things that I feared most came upon me. Even though he was a rich man and a wealthy man, he always was, what always was bothering his mind, what if I lost this, I lost all. And he said, when Satan, of course, afflicted him, destroyed his material stuff, he says, the thing that I feared most came upon me. So within every person, there is some secret fear. And of course, you are not doing what you're supposed to because of some fear. Sometimes we're afraid of people. We have all kinds of threats today. We have the threats of terrorism. We have the threat of bandits, thieves. You're going to school, you have the threat of bullies. You send your child out to pedophilias, drug addicts, drug pushers, name it as you. Some people don't go to Trinidad for what reason? Why are you? Some are afraid to go to Trinidad. Why? Because you're afraid that you're going to die. You're afraid they're going to take you out. But David is saying to us, and God has said to us, we need to be fearless. Because only people who are fearless is able to do great things. What fear brings depression. Fear affects your immune system, I'm told. Fear causes you to have relationships, not healthy relationships. Fear. So David tells us about being fearless, and he tells us why, and God himself teaches us why we should not be fearful. He said, first of all, that he had confidence. He says that I shall not fear. I shall not be afraid. He says, I fear nothing and no one. What gives him that confidence? It's because the confidence is based upon, first of all, you will see, he was confident because he had a relationship with the Lord. He said, the Lord is my. You say the Lord is a light, you know. You say the Lord is my light. You say, I know there are many lights, but the Lord is my light. I know he's a light, but he's my light. Some of you bright people, I think my is a pronoun. Some say, some in some places is defined as an adjective. It is a personal possessive. I don't know if I'm right or making up the new language. A personal possessive pronoun. Mine, belong to me, that's my own. He said, listen, and I want you to understand the Lord. Understand what you don't understand this? No. He says, the Lord is mine. He didn't say anything, you know. He said, the Lord is, I shall not fear, I shall not be afraid. Why? Because I am in relationship with the Lord, not a Lord, the Lord. The word for Lord, I will look at it again, it's an interesting word, was first mentioned, of course, if you read, you know, you do the Greek is Kairos and Adonai, the Hebrew will mention Adonai, but the Lord he mentions here, you will see it is written in what? Right, in capitalized letters, all capital. And I want to say, it did say, but I don't know what is the subject of your psalm? What does it say that psalm is about? What does it say? Right. Declaration of faith. But some will say, because different Bibles have different headings, some will say it's a psalm that David wrote when God gave him rest from all his enemies. All his enemies. He was at peace. And probably one day he sat back in hindsight, also looking into the future, he says, the Lord. The word there, you see that capitalized letter? Anywhere you see capitalized letter in the Bible, the specific, the only Hebrew word was used there is the word they call Yahweh. Anywhere you see L, the L and common one, Adonai. So he's saying to you that I'm in relationship with Yahweh, and the first time God revealed that name, it was to Moses. No other person God revealed that, not to Abraham, not to Isaac. They knew him as El Shaddai, El Elyon, the strong one, the breasted one. They knew him as that. But the first time God revealed that name is when he said, Moses, who should you say when I go to the people? Who should I say, send me? He said, I am sent you. The Hebrew word originally was like E-H-Y-E-H, E-H-Y-E-H, E-H. Translated into Yahweh, and some of the scholars say, you know, we're really not sure how to pronounce it. It is not Jehovah. Jehovah Witness tell you Jehovah is his name. No, of course, that is what we call a transliteration into our language. But there's no J in the Hebrew alphabet. It's not really Jesus, but it's Yeshua. But I will make bones out of that. So, you know, transliteration, a rose is still a rose. Ababa, oh, if you want to say this, why it'll make you feel more religious. No, I will say, Daddy. You know, I know some people, you feel more nice when you say, Baba, oh. I don't care if it's Baba, oh. If I say daddy, same thing. In my dialect, in my language, daddy, say papa. Or I call my father, I used to call him Daddy Stan. His name was All Stan. I don't know, for some reason, I was saying Daddy Stan. Maybe that's a powerful name, Daddy Stan. So he said, listen, Yahweh is a covenant God. the God of promise. The God who keeps promises. He's a self-existent one. The creator, the sustainer, the redeemer of the universe, the ruler of the universe. It also means the sovereign God. He rules everything. He's above everything. Of course, we say omnipotent, he's omniscient, he's omnipresent. All of that is packed into that way. And I love what, you know, what it really means. It says, when it says, it means the one who is, the one who was, and the one who will be. Let me say, you know, a lot of people sing it and hear people say it. I am. I will be to you whatever you want me to be. Whatever you need. Whatever your needs are, that time, I am that. That's why I say, we call him, we say Jehovah Rapha. You're looking for a healer, I am that. That's why the same thing David did in Psalm 23, and I will try to pull all these things together, because you have to understand he's speaking about his life, and he said it many times in different ways. He said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Then he says, he's a provider. He's a protector. You read that psalm. Now what he's saying, the Lord is all of that to me. So therefore, I shall not want. No, he's using the metaphor of light. He said, the Lord is my light. I shall not fear. He says, look who is my... He said, there are many people who have different lights, you know. When you say, Lord is my light, it means that people have other lights. Some people have gurus. Some people have special prophets. Some people have people who practice speaking to the dead, seance people, psychic people. These are the people who give them information. These are the people who, some people look at the horoscope every day, because that is the, whoever writes it, he is the person who controls your life. God's, David said, it's not the star, not the moon, not people, but he said, the Lord is my light, man. And I've learned he's a possessor. You know what he's saying? I am his, and he is mine. I belong to him, and he belongs to me. I realize that when knowledge of a relationship, knowing whose you are and who you are, it makes you invincible, fearless. You know, if you know, man, if you know a drug dealer, it's a bad, you know, not one to use, but if you know the person in love until... I shouldn't call any name, but if you know the drug dealer in some places and he's a gangster and he's bad, but you went to school with him and you know him, you say, hey, what boy, be yourself now, boy. Why don't you cool yourself? Who could talk to him like that? Only you. Because you and he was so. No other part of the ways, but still, there's that connection, and you could say, hey, I have some big guys. You know what I mean? They're big men now with children. And when they was little, you know, they were, you know, where they lived, they were, you know, in hard times, you know, times were tough, and I used to give them food, teach them how to cook, they were making better calories than me, and all that stuff. But I could call Jangi, even though I could call Jangi right now. I said, Roger, from Jangi, Roger, I need you to get him. He said, okay, cut it, let me go. Big as he is. Why? Because of the relationship we have. And when you are known, when people know you know people, sometimes they're afraid of you. Because if, that's why some sisters hook up with gangsters, you know. If you know, let me tell you something. If you know that is a bad man, and that's your partner, you know they're afraid to touch you. You know that? If you have a lot of brothers or sisters and somebody wants to do you harm, they say, oh, nah, boy, hey, you don't know who is that person, brother or sister. Boy. I remember looking at Denzel Washington Training Day. I don't know if you remember that. And some guys almost raped a girl. But one of the guy who was in Training Day, who Denzel was training, he rescued her. He didn't know he didn't know that was one of the drug lords or the gangster's niece. And he found himself in a place where they're about to kill him. And he says, but when they saw some picture, they realized he rescued, and they let him off the hook. When you know God, you are known in the underworld, man. When you know God, the devil knows you. When you know God, the devil and demons are afraid of you. The Bible tells us a lot of time, but 2 Samuel 18, it says when Saul saw that God was with David, he was afraid of him. When people know that you and God are tight, they say, don't touch that man. Don't play with that brother, you know. Don't play with that sister, you know, because you don't know who he knows. You don't know who is his father. David didn't say father because, you know, in that time, the reverence for God and God never had that kind of relationship in terms of revealing to people, I'm your father, but he had a relationship. So, you know, when you are known who you're hooking up with, who you're hanging out with, people fear you. So the demon says to the sons of Sceva, I know Paul. I know Jesus. Jesus and Paul tight. But you're calling his name. But I don't know. You don't know up here. You don't have a relationship with Jesus. Lick like fire. So when David was confident in the midst, he said, I'm fearless because, listen, God is my father. He's my light. I am in relation with Jehovah Jireh. Listen, my friend, when you know God, you have a boldness. The people that know their God will be strong. I want to encourage you to know God for yourself. Know God for yourself. The pastor may know God for himself. The prophet may know God for himself. You need to know God for yourself. That is where you get your confidence in life. That is where you walk around. You walk on this planet as a victim, not feeling that you are the mercy of anybody. You walk with confidence and power, even though you walk humbly. He says, the Lord. It's important. Relationship, those of you children who people bullying you. You have to know God. No God, otherwise they will push you up and bully you, and you will all live in fear and terror. Because I said to you, even though you switch school, your parents may think that is good, but they're waiting for you outside of school. See, this is the irony, you know. Listen, nobody could, Jesus God, nobody could really protect you, no friend. Understand it in reality. Of course, security guard could do their part, but 24/7? Unless you want to pay for MI, not just MI in Tobago, you know, get some the English MI, and they still assassinate presidents and kill congressmen. This is a land of wolves and devils and demons. David was not denying that there are enemies looking. He did not deny the reality that they are enemies of your life. He says, but I, some people are afraid of terrorism, terror, they're afraid of everything. They're afraid of traveling, this, they're afraid of traveling, that, they're afraid, they're shut down in life. Some people are afraid to take position in church, they're shut down. They will have you right where he wants. Afraid of what? Afraid of what? Afraid of what? Afraid of what? Afraid of what man will say? Afraid of what? What are you afraid about? You know, no, I no, what are you afraid of? What are you afraid about? When you know God, he says, when you stand on a solid rock, you know the power that you have. Really, we live in, you know, sometimes in discussion with them, and you know, we live in below our possibilities. We live in as though one man said, "Boy, people, Christian afraid to confront people. Christian afraid to walk the streets. Christian afraid to go in certain places to talk about God." What? For God has not given us the spirit. Easy to say these things, you know. But to live it is something else. David said, "I'm fearless." Why? Why? I'm fearless is because of whose I am. And who am I? I have an intimate relationship with God. You observe something? Peter and John in the Bible, before Pentecost, they were coward men. After Pentecost, they said, "We'll kill all you." He said, "Well, beat all you." He said, "Listen, we don't care what they do. But we want to obey God and man." Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they said, hey, king, we don't care about what you do. We know our God is what? Our God is what? So if your God is him, if your God is Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, what is your problem? Is that you believe it or you don't? See, this is the difference. Do you believe it? Do you believe what you say you believe? Paul said, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Of course, some context and say all things like what? But the principle is truth. The true principle is this, that when you know God, impossible is nothing. He says, "I'm confident. I go through this life fearless." Why? Because I know who I belong to. I know who belongs to me. And we connected, we tight. His confidence, he says, secondly, his confidence was as a result of the presence, the continual presence of God in his life. He said it this way. He said, "The Lord is my light." In the Bible, light is a metaphor as used, especially by John, he tries to use it too. You will see light and darkness. This contrasting metaphor, light and darkness. And light is a metaphor that is called what? For luminous presence. In other words, light is always bright and shining. It you know that it's shining. We all call it present. It's luminous. And light as a metaphor eliminates darkness. Darkness is not equal to light. Darkness is a metaphor that is used for evil, ignorance, wickedness, immorality, name it, anything that's anti-God, or what some scholars say, the antithesis of good. You name it, it is dark. Darkness also sometimes define your experience psychologically. You say, I feel like in a dark hole. I'm in the dark about this. I don't know. So David said, "The Lord, why I'm so confident? Because God is always present with me."